want you to see this. Hallelujah. Amen. And so let's look at this verse here. Hallelujah. Amen. Oh, Father's so good. Father's so good. Amen. Are you so good? Is God so good? All the time. You ready for more of God? You ready for the Word? I'm telling you, church, get ready. Get ready. What's going to happen? Something is happening even now in your hearts, in your spirit. Hallelujah. Amen. Oh, Jesus is so good. Amen. There's so much that I want to go into, but I'm just going to focus on this. Notice what it says. We all know this. For God so loved the world. Come on, church. Let's look at it again like we've never seen it for the like we've never seen it before. For so God loved the world, and we're in it, that he, God, should be capitalized, gave his only begotten Jesus. In him should not perish. In him we would not perish. So if I can extract more from the scripture, we're in the world through the power of God. Jesus is taking care of us while we're in this world because God loves us. I want you to think about it. God loves me. I want you to say with me, God loves me. See, a lot of times we spend a lot of time telling God we love him, and that's good. But we focus on, Father, I love you. I love you, which is good. I'm a father, and I love that when children tell me that. But I love it when they say, Daddy, you love me. I think that sounds stronger. I love my father. You can say, you can tell your daddy, I love you, Daddy, or Mama, whoever. I love you, I love you, I love you. There's something better when they hear you say, but you love me. You love me. I want you to think about it. You love me. Say it with me. God loves me. I want you to see yourself as a child of God. God loves me. God loves me. God loves me. God knows I love him because I tell him I love him. But I understand that he loves me. He placed me in a world, gave me Jesus, gave me a protection. Jesus is with me. So that means there's something that God has for me in this world. I'm just not another bump on the log. I'm just another number or with a Social Security born in a certain country, state. But there's something about why I'm born in this generation. I could have been born in any other generation. You and I could have been born in our great-grandfather's generation. But there's something about this generation. God loves me. I'm born in this generation. God loves me. And then you start realizing the Lord's coming for us, and yet we're part of this great end-time revelation of power that God is going to use us in this time. Think about it. It's a big thing. It's big when you start realizing that I'm here. God loves me. God loves me. Who hates me? The enemy hates me. The enemy doesn't want me to prosper. The enemy doesn't want me to recognize who I am. The enemy doesn't want me to be healthy. The enemy doesn't love me. He's a father of lies. The truth is not in him. So we're listening to a lie. I'm saying we're people that without God are listening to a lie. But he loves me. Say it with me. He loves me. He loves me. He loves me. He loves me. Do you believe that? I want everybody to tell your neighbor, man, I believe it. Go ahead and tell your neighbor, I believe it. 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 Amen. There's no question about it. Say it with me. There's no question about it. No question. So if God loves me, now listen to what I'm going to say. If God loves me, Lana, if God loves you, Lana, if God loves us, I love that. If he loves us, then he's got a purpose for me. Now notice this. Purpose has much involved in it. Purpose. But see, it begins first by knowing the purpose of God, being in the things of God, in the household of the family of God. I've learned more in the house of God than I did running a business. I've learned more in the house of God how to live strong, healthy, long in the house of God. And I'll take it further. As a pastor, I've married people in the house of God. I've baptized people in the house of God. I gay funerals in the house of God. I dedicated children in the house of God. I've given communion in the house of God. I received people to know Jesus in the house of God. People receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost in the house of God. It's a high percentage. People have learned more in the house of God. So you see, the purpose of the Lord is so that you can understand. The purpose that God has for you is something great, and we're going to find it in the household of faith. Can you say amen? How many people know that is nothing but the honest truth? It's in the household of God. Now, I worked in the business. I know the street. I know the world's attitude, and I know the economics of the world and how to make money. And that system is crashing fast. I mean, look at the stock market. I'm telling you, things are happening fast. United Nations are already making plans to switch over our dollar. And Europe is already working that, and they're kind of scared of that. You know, we have our president that wants to run for the United Nations secretary. And so you can imagine what he's did at our country and what the United Nations, what he wants with the United Nations. You see, it doesn't stop when we're not of the faithful of God family. It doesn't stop. There's more for us. But also there's more out there. It's going to get darker out there. How many people know that's the truth? Can you say amen? That's the truth. It's getting darker out there, right? It's getting darker. Christine was reading in a neighborhood. And I won't mention the neighborhood, but there are men in a neighborhood, in not far from my neighborhood, that are meeting for a militia attitude. Not far from my neighborhood. What's happening? It's because there's fear. Some people have, you know, this gun issues going on. You know, there's a lot of things happening. Well, there's more that's taking place. I would say that in a church, I would say 85% of people are already thinking about carrying guns. Now, y'all look at me like this is a new thing. Come on, church. In this church, I know two that have carry, what is it called, Brother Bo? Conceal and carry. And I asked the person, I said, are you bringing it? She said, no, Pastor, I don't bring it. Oh, no, don't bring it in church. We went fishing at where all the wolves are. And we went fishing. A lot of coyotes are out there. And one of the guys that was carrying, you know, says, Pastor, that's okay. We're going to be all right. All you heard was a, you know. And so you understand that's happening. I mean, it's because there is a move out there that's taken place, and it's gotten into the church. It really has. There's things that are taking place. Can you say, all right? Come on, church, amen. Now notice this. I want you to see something. I want you to look at Isaiah, the 14th chapter. Take notes. Rehear this. When it's released by tomorrow, we'll give you the link so that you can rehear it. Go with me to Isaiah 14 chapter. Hallelujah. Amen. The 14th chapter. Look at verses 27. I want you to see something here. The Lord of hosts hath sworn. The Lord of hosts hath sworn, saying, now this is a promise. He sworn on this promise. Surely, as I have thought, so it shall come to pass. And as I have purposed, so shall it stand. Drop all the way down to verse 26, and we understand what he's saying here. Verse 26 says, this is the purpose that is purposed upon the earth, and this is the hand that is stretched out upon all the nations. So let's take this into where we are today. God has a purpose. You can't reverse the plans of God. Are you listening, church? You can't reverse the plans of God. What God has purposed, it's going to happen. You can't reverse the coming of the Lord. It's going to happen. You can't reverse Israel become a nation. It's become a nation of June of 1948, May of 1948. You can't reverse that. You can't reverse the things that God has set in motion. Now, let me ask you something. Isn't it amazing? And let's just talk about something real quickly. I mean, and we're not going to be on that scale, but isn't it amazing how the church has awoken with our administration? Come on, church, amen, if you agree or say, I don't agree, or I don't know. Isn't it amazing because of our administration that we have the churches praying more? Come on, church, did y'all get what I'm saying? Have you been praying more since we've had our our president for eight years now? Have we been praying more? We've been praying more, right? What's happening? The church has awakened, right? There's much things. We're getting revelation. We're getting understanding. Things are taking place. You know, there's so much that if you literally start looking at it, these, you know, I think about, and I think about this. How many people would love to prosper? Raise your hand. I would love to prosper. Come on, everybody, raise your hand. Come on, everybody, raise your hand. I mean, really, if you don't want to prosper, I can agree for your prosperity to come to my hands, right? Amen, hallelujah. Give me your paycheck every week if you don't want it, right? Now, notice this. We all want prosperity. Why? Because we live in a land of freedom, free, right? We want prosperity, right? But now the second question is this: can God trust us what He's already given us? If you base on asking God for prosperity, can He trust you with what He has already given you? Before we go to the next step, we have to have some trust value here. We have to, in other words, we've got to know our prosperity is for a reason, our blessing is for a reason. God's blessed us financially for a reason, right? Not just to splurge on your own and forget about the world. It's about really, God, the Bible says that He has prospered us so that we can be a blessing to others. I want you to think about it. If we can be a blessing to others, think about how the door of the gospel opened. Think about, you just feel like taking someone to the grocery store. Listen, guys, go into Walmart grocery and the budget is $200. You go in there and buy whatever you want and I'll be out with a truck. Well, I need a truck to pick up all the groceries. So I'll be out there. You guys go in there. Think about the message you're sending to those people. I think about, wouldn't you love to do that? Come on, church, be honest. Wouldn't you love to do that? Oh, Jesus, that would be wonderful. Wonderful, right? But see, before you do that to someone, don't you want to know, will they handle this $200? Will they be able to handle? I mean, when you go in there, make sure you buy food. Nothing that's going to be against what I'm asking you to do. Can we trust Him? You see, this is why our country is now standing asking God for breakthrough in our lives. Can He trust us with what He's given us? So in other words, according to Isaiah, God says, I purpose something. I'm purposing something, and I'm not going to revert to it. I'm doing it, and it's going to bring the glory more. How many people believe in John 3:16? For God so loved the world. Wasn't it a purpose for God to do that? Come on, church, really. It's a two-way communication. Wasn't it a purpose of God to do that, to send His Son into the world? Or was it just something last minute He thought about, oops, I got to send Jesus. Jesus, you go. No, it was a purpose plan. And if you study the purpose plan, it was because from the Garden of Eden, there was a problem that happened. It wasn't intended. And then you may say, well, God, why did God allow that? No, God gave man and woman the free agent to do, to serve, and to do what's right. Satan got into it, right? And from that moment on, that's the problem that's in the world. It all originated from the Garden of Eden, and that's where it's at. But God's purpose is still there. So Jesus had to come to set us free. Thank God. Through Jesus Christ, we're prosperous. Thank God. Through Jesus Christ, He's blessed us. You study Galatians. It talks about through Jesus Christ why we're made whole. It was through Jesus Christ that the blessing of Abraham might come upon us. Abraham's been gone a long time ago, but the blessing was left on Abraham, and it is through Jesus Christ that we have that blessing of Abraham. Tell your neighbor, I'm blessed because of Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. So in other words, it's a purpose. Say with me, it's going to happen. The Almighty God has purpose. Let me read to you from the NIV. For the Lord Almighty has purpose. Who can thwart Him? His hand is stretched out, and who can turn it back? Amen. God has a plan for the household of faith, and it's not going to be thwarted. It's not going to be reverted, but He's going to do it. He's purposing it in you. You are here for a purpose. You were born at such a time as this. God has a plan for you. I'm telling you, folks, you got to lay hold of that and believe, I have a purpose in this time for Jesus Christ to do a work in this land. I purposed it. John 3:16. We believe it, right? You believe it? We believe it. We believe it. Now, from this moment on, I'm going to push you now into something. The reason why I say push you is because I feel like I want to encourage you. This is what separates many people from believing that God loves us. Let's first of all acknowledge, where does poverty come from? Come on, everybody. Speak loud. Speak it loud. Curse. It's a curse. Poverty is a curse. It's not God's intention for us, for the people of His creation, to live in poverty. It's not God's will. It's not God's will. You are to stand on that promise if you've ever had any financial lack. I don't care if you got to pay your light bill and this is the only dollar you have left to pay your light bill. You need to take a stance that it is not God's will for me to live in lack. Say with me, it's not God's will for me to live in lack. Now, there are people that believe that God purposes that on us. No, He doesn't. There's nothing in the Bible that says He purposes for you to be in lack. He wants you to be blessed. He removes the curse. I'm telling you, church, if there is ever a problem in your area of finances or sickness or anything that you just can't get over and it's not God's plan, you have every right, according to the Word of God, to stand on that authority and say, Father, this is not your will, so I take authority over this lack and I use the Word of God. I'm telling you, you've got to break yourself out of that. But there's people that will teach it, well, you know, it's God's will for you to be poor. It's God's will for you to be sick. God wants to teach you something. I love all my children. I don't want my children to be taught by way of sickness. Jason, I love you, so I want tuberculosis on you so that God can learn, teach you something. No. I love Teresa so much, and I come here, I'm going to break your legs so you can learn something. No. See, what happens is because of the loss of revelation or understanding of the Word of God, or maybe not being in the household of faith, we assume that grandma said this and this is gospel. I'm not in church, but grandma said that I can be poor. It's okay to be poor. So because I don't have anything, God loves me. He loves you, but it's not His plan for you to be poor. Well, that's what grandma said. Bless grandma. She probably loved you and prayed you, teach you, but she probably did not read the word where it talked about, and the blessings of the Lord shall be upon you. Jesus, for the sake, died for us in poverty so that we may be rich. Didn't die in poverty. He died on the cross so that poverty can be broken off your life. Right? So this is why we need to be of the household of faith. Listen, if we're going to be not studying the Word of God and then going to church and then hearing a message that's from the Word of God and then start judging it that it's not right, who are we to judge a message from the Word of God if we've never been in church? I mean, do you know people like that? They'll tell you something in the Word of God, but they don't go to church. They'll tell you that tithing's not gospel. Well, do you go to church? No, I don't go to church. Well, how can you tell me tithing's not gospel? Come on, church. I'm talking. We're going somewhere with this, right? So in other words, we're people out of the household of faith. So what happens is we're coming to a family of the household of faith and we're learning the Word of God and the Bible's being expressed by the power of the Holy Ghost and it's changing our thinking because God has a purpose. And see, He engineered in us a tremendous work, so He has to clean whatever was in us. And it happens in the household of faith. I mean, I'll be honest with you, or you can be honest with me. Does your job sit you down and teach you the oracles of the Bible? Does your boss say, everybody, let's gather around the lunchroom, bring your Bibles, and let's talk about faith right now. We're going to spend 2 hours. Don't answer the phones. No. See, it's a different zone. It's a different rank. It's a different thing that you're having. And thank God for those jobs that do have that stuff. Amen. That's awesome. But it's of the household of faith that we get the Word of God. And I love this. Now, notice what it says. I want you to just look at something here. Go with me to Genesis, the 15th chapter now. Remember, God has purposed something in us. I'm created for a purpose under heaven. God loves me. He knows I love Him, but He loves me. Oh, God loves me. God, I thank You. You love me. You love me. You love me. You have a purpose for me in this generation. You've designed something. I'm in the household of faith. I'm learning. I'm gleaning from You. I'm removing all that mess that the world's taught me for years. Maybe what grandma's taught me, and I love my grandma. I love my great-grandfather. I love them, but they just didn't know. the Word of God, and I love them. I love them. They taught me how to love, but now I'm in the household of God now. I'm learning the Word of God. Hallelujah. Amen. Look what it says in Genesis, the 15th chapter. Oh, Jesus, I tell you, we're just getting in it. Just getting it right in it. Just getting right in it. Hallelujah. Amen. Notice what it says in Genesis, the 15th chapter, verse 13. Are you there? Hallelujah. Amen. And he, God, said unto Abram. Remember, this was Abraham. This was Abram, but it would have been, later on it was changed to Abraham. Know of surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in the land that is not theirs, and it shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years. And also that nation whom they shall serve will I judge, and afterwards shall they come out with great substance. Now let me read it to you from the Message Bible. Know for sure. I love that. Know for sure is going to happen. God said to Abraham, know this, your descendants will live as outsiders in the land not theirs. They'll be enslaved and beaten down for 400 years. Then I'll punish their slave masters. Your offspring will march out of there loaded with plunder. This is a good time to say amen. Now notice, remember, it's the purpose of God. Now notice what happened here. Before Abraham, or God told Abram, Abram, your seed is going to go into slavery for 400 years. That's the Jewish people. They went into slavery for 400 years under the Babylonian rule. 400 years. And they'll be beaten by slave owners. But surety, I promise you, he's saying, it's going to happen. They're going to leave. The slave masters are going to hand over all their plunder, and they're coming out. Just now, notice what it says. They're coming out. What does the Bible say? They're coming out loaded with plunder. Or listen to what it says. They're coming out with great substance. Your offspring is coming out loaded. Now, this is God's promise to the people of Israel. I promise you, God told Abram, Abram, your children, your seed is going to go into slavery for 400 years. I promise you. But when they leave, they're going to be loaded with plunder. That happened. They left loaded with plunder. Now, if you study the Exodus, if you watch movies about the Exodus, you study the Bible about the Exodus, they left with plunder. They left with gold and silver and linen purple. They left mighty. They left mighty, mighty. You see, so in other words, God purposed that. Now, notice this. I want you to think about this for a moment. If God purposed that to happen to them, what is his purpose for us? It's in the Word of God. If he promised their seed that they're going to come out loaded with plunder, what has he promised us that's going to happen to us after Jesus? Do you believe it? How many of you believe John 3:16? Raise your hand. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. That's a promise. But now, from now to everlasting life, there's a purpose that God has for you. It's a tremendous purpose. And let's look at it. I want you to see this. This is going to give you some authority. Now, I want you to look at Ecclesiastes now. Go with me to Ecclesiastes. I hear people read this, but they read it in a good understanding, but they miss much of why this is happening. Now, notice what it says here, and I want you to read it. Chapter 3, verses 1 in Ecclesiastes. Ecclesiastes 3. Now, Ecclesiastes is go ahead and go to the margin of your Bible, or it's before, before Psalms? Or no, right after Proverbs. Right after Proverbs is Ecclesiastes. Now, I want you to see this. Amen? Amen? Hallelujah. Ecclesiastes 3, verse 1. To everything there is a season. Did you know that for everything there is a season and time to every purpose under heaven? Let me read it this way. Every day there is a season for you, and every day there is a purpose for you under heaven. Today, there's a reason why you're sitting at the Oasis Center Church. There's a reason why There's a season why you're sitting here. There's a purpose why you're sitting here. Tomorrow there's a reason why you're there. Tomorrow there's a reason why you have a purpose, the purpose for that day. So in other words, it's building up every day. So say with me, every day, there's a purpose. There's a season. Every day. So that means today you have a purpose. How many people miss today's purpose by not being in the household of faith? How many people would miss God's purpose simply by doing something that just gives feed to their flesh? Amen? That movie that talks about concussion, I haven't seen it. A friend of mine seen it. He says, you need to go see it. How many people have seen it? Concussion? In one of the scenes, it says, we succeeded by replacing church with football. Notice this, we succeeded in replacing church with football. Now, you know what that means, right? The goal was to get viewers to watch football on Sunday. And mostly Christians, I remember one time, football was early in the morning on Sunday. I mean, early in the morning, and I remember as being a pastor in Houston, there were many people that would miss church simply to watch football, and I would say, I understand, I mean, they love football, but they didn't have DVRs at the time, so they couldn't record it, but it's amazing how people, I remember in the sound booth, Brother DeMilo, in the sound room was the sound equipment and a little TV. No, they were watching TV, the cameramen. I was in the sound booth, and I remember going up there telling the guys, how dare y'all turn on that TV? I remember somebody told me in the rafters of this church up there, they're watching television, football, and it was a Super Bowl day. They're watching it, and even the assistant, the youth pastor was up there along with the ushers watching while the preacher's preaching downstairs, and they start shouting up there when the football or they went wherever the game they were watching had a goal. And pastor says, what are you guys doing up there in the middle of a service? And I thought to myself, my goodness, that's pretty bold, right? That is pretty serious. I mean, really, I think they had no revelation of what they were doing in church. They didn't realize, wow, he just substituted God for a football game. But notice this, there's a purpose under heaven, and it's now. It's now. We have purpose under heaven. Say with me, we have a purpose under heaven. Hallelujah. Amen. Go with me to the second chapter of Ecclesiastes. The second chapter. Verses 26. Verses 26. For God giveth to a man or woman that is good to his sight, and knowledge and joy, but to the sinner, the unbeliever, he giveth travail to gather and to heap up, that he may give to him that is good before God. Oh, come on. This is vanity and vexation of the spirit. You know what is vanity and vexation of the spirit? Is that this is literally happening now. I remember when I wasn't serving the Lord, money went through my pants like nothing. Or money went through. I remember we would spend our money before. I mean, right before the money ever went to the bank, it was already called for. How many people know what I'm talking about? Have you ever been there? Have you ever been there where literally you get a paycheck and you don't have anything by Monday morning? I mean, it's like you have holes, something happened. Every bill collector is after you, and you're just like, wow, don't have anything. Then we go to church, and that attitude is we don't have anything. You know what I'm saying? It's an awful thing, right? So I've been there. I've hated it. I hate it. That's why I tell you, church, believe God to get debt free. Believe God. Every time you go to the mailbox, confess, Father, I thank you that I'm debt-free in Jesus' name. I owe no one nothing but a debt of love. Isn't it awesome to owe no one nothing but just to tell them I love you? Hey, man, I love you, man. Don't owe anything to anybody. I love you, man. I love you. The only debt that I owe is to say I love you. I love you, Sinji. I love you, Bo. I owe no one nothing but it's a beautiful feeling. It's a beautiful feeling not having anything. I remember, and I tell you earlier, that we were so much in debt that we were scared to go to the mailbox. I would send Jason, little guy, and go get the mail. Give it to mom. Give it to dad. Give it to Jennifer. Throw it away. I mean, we were just scared. I mean, poor mailman, he was a good man, and we hated him. he would bring us all those bad news. You see, so what's happening here, God says this, he's purposed this, and one of the things that we have to believe God for is there is a purpose for everything under heaven, and there's a time for everything under heaven, and this is the purpose that we live in according to this scripture. Now the Bible says the wealth, now this is where I'm gonna encourage you to move forward and believe this. Don't get out of that religious attitude that God wants us poor. No, God wants you prosperous. So in other words, listen, church. It's not your job that's going to make you rich. I'm going to say it again. It's not your job that's going to make you rich. It's the seed that your job gives you that's going to make you prosperous. It's the seed. Because the seed has harvest. I told a brother today, your seed has harvest. And I'm telling you, my seed, when I sow my seed, I'm immediately seeing the harvest of it. I'm immediately. There was a time that I would sow by faith and I would say, Lord, I'm standing on your word, Lord, but I don't see the return of this, but I'm standing on your word. Let me tell you something. The getting into it by faith and believing God, it's going to prosper. It's going to work. There's a season. I'm telling you, farmers love it when there's a season that all harvest is coming in and they got the right rain and things are happening. Oh, man, they're hiring people, pickers, and they're hiring all these things to go get their fruit. Oh, they love it. But they also remember scarcity. They don't like scarcity. They're borrowing from the seed that should have been planted 2 years ago. So what's happening, now God says this, if you believe there's a purpose for you, now start believing that in this time that we're living, he's going to make you prosperous. Come on, church, you ought to say amen. He's going to make you prosperous. Now let's look at it again. I want you to see this for scripture's sake. It says here, he says, for he giveth to a man that is good to his sight, wisdom and knowledge. You need to have that. And joy, but to the sinner. Say it with me, to the sinner. The sinner is the unbeliever of Jesus Christ that doesn't believe in Jesus, doesn't believe in the Word of God, and doesn't care where his wealth goes to. He doesn't care. Now notice what it says here in verse 26. But to the sinner he giveth travail to gather, to heap up, that he may give to him that is good before God. So in other words, let me read it to you from the Good News Bible. God gives wisdom, knowledge, happiness to those who please him, but he makes sinners work, earning and saving, so that what they get can be given to those who please him. Now let me tell you something. This is happening now. It's happening, church. You got to believe this. It's happening. We were at a restaurant the other day, and we asked the waiter, we need our bill. And she says, you know what? It's already taken care of. Praise God. Amen. 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 See, we're seeing these things start taking place. The other day, we're going down the freeway, and I told Christine, there's some money flying, and man, I just saw maybe $4 flying down the highway, and it was so windy, that money was just rolling. And you know, someone out there is going to recover that, but someone lost it. We were at a hotel, right, Bo? We're at a hotel, and we're getting ready to have service. That's when we were meeting at the hotel down the road. And I got down, and all of a sudden, I saw a $10 bill just floating by. Put my foot on it, I got it. And then there was another $10 bill, and I put my foot on it, got it. And I went to church with $20, and Bo met me. How much did you find, Bo? $20 also floating down. Now, let me tell you something. I'm going to tell you something now. You may not realize, you may think that's just a coincidence, but no. If I can tell you, Jason, can you make it a little warmer? I know for a fact that I've seen this many times. Christine was raking Jennifer's house one day, and my wife Christine asked me, honey, why is it you always finding money? I want you to pray for me that I'll find money. So I said, okay, give me your hand, right, Christine? I prayed, Father, as you're no respecter person, what you did for me, do for my wife. And Lord, I just ask you to do it today in Jesus' name. So I went to the back cutting trees. I was cutting some bushes for Jennifer's. And all of a sudden, I hear a scream. Pastor Christine is raking this deep leaves. So you can imagine how many, the other leaves were probably there for years. So she's raking that up. It's all wet and almost rotted and muddy. And there is a muddy $20 bill that is just sticking up. She gets it, takes the mud up. Look what God gave me. And you know what? I just said, well, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. I just kept cutting. Why did I have such a confidence in that? Because I believe God's did it to me many times. I'm telling you, I've been out of my backyard, my air conditioning income, or whatever you call that thing, denser, twice. Had $20 bills at two separate times. Twice. Just stuck on it twice. I'm finding money. Now, let me. You may say, well, that's you're just lucky. No, it has nothing to do with luck. It has with believing God that this scripture works. Every day we believe God, that God is doing a miraculous thing in our life, and it involves the working of God. And if it has to be in finances, let it be God. Amen. Constantly sowing. We have a heart attitude of sowing. Always sowing. Why? Because we know that God's the one that uses us. You see, this is the thing that we have to understand. Listen, church, I'm telling you some principles that are going to help you. Now, think about it. Whatever you touch, listen, Bobby, whatever you touch, you put God in it. You find a dollar bill, put God in it. You find a $20, put God in it. Always think about God and find it. Don't think it's luck. Oh, I'm lucky. Let's go gamble this. No. I'm talking about put God in it. I found a $20 bill. Father, I thank you, Lord. Lord, I just thank you. I can't wait to church to give you the tenth of this. $2 I'm going to give you, Father. What do you do? Oh, give it all. That morning we found $20 bills. I put in the offering that morning. Come on, church. You see, so in other words, there is a purpose. Start believing God. Start building your faith and believing God. God, there's a purpose. You don't want me poor. You want me blessed. There's a purpose. There's a purpose for finances. There's a purpose for being healthy. There's a purpose why you caused me to attract finances. There's a purpose. And the devil wanted me to be bound in debt. And I know, Father, I'm free. See, you put that to work. Come on, church. You ought to say amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Go meet a Job. Now, find Job. Where's Job? Bone? Huh? Before Psalms. Go to Job, the 27th chapter. Amen? Are you getting some, church? Come on, church. You're going to walk out of here 10 feet tall now. Amen? 10 feet tall. Hallelujah. Amen? Job 27. Look what it says in verse 13. Hallelujah. Amen? Oh, Jesus is good. Verse 27. This is the portion of the wicked man with God. Remember, God's given the righteous a purpose. God's given the righteous a purpose. But notice the purpose for a wicked man. I think about this. Now notice, look at me, everybody, right now. I don't want you to start feeling bad for wicked sinners. Don't feel bad in this sense. Feel for them that they need Jesus, but don't feel bad for what God is saying, because this is a purpose thing that's going to happen. You love the ungodly and you tell them about Jesus, but don't get into a pity party. Well, why are they losing everything? Why are they going in debt? Why are they getting sick? Let me tell you something, church. This is happening. I'm telling you, we get phone calls of prayer requests all over the world that people that are going through so much. But yet, like I said, God's going to raise the church up in this hour. All right, now notice what it says. I'm going to give you a story in a little bit. That's a true story right now in Time Magazine. Notice what it says in Job, the 27th chapter. Did I say 27? Verse 13. This is the portion of the wicked man with God and the heritage of the oppressor, which they shall receive of the Almighty. Say with me, the wicked shall receive something from the Almighty. Come on, church, say it with me. Come on. Drop down on verse 16. Though he, the sinner, heap up silver as dust and prepare raiments as the clay, he may prepare it, but the just, underline it, shall put it on, and the innocent shall divide the silver. Now, let me read it to you from this place. It says, here is the fate God allotted to the wicked. Here is the fate that God allotted to the wicked. The heritage a ruthless man receives from the Almighty God. Though he heaps up silver like dust and clothes like piles of clay, what he lays up for the righteous will wear. What he lays up for the righteous will wear, and the innocent will divide his silver. So in other words, this is the proportion plan that God has. It's happening now. Let me give you the story real quick. It's happening right now. In Detroit, Michigan, they're in millions of dollars of deficit. And the water company decided not to buy from Detroit, Flint, Michigan. So they decided to pump their drinking water from a river and have it cleaned. Turned out to be this river has high levels of lead. Now, children are going into the emergency rooms with high level of lead. Let me tell you, it affects the brain. It affects everything in the blood system for a child, especially the brain that's growing. And it causes children to be deficit or brain damaged. Now, notice this. The EPA did a study of it. They told Flint, Michigan, what's happening. They hid it. Why? They hid it because, see, they were in deficit. The water department was in deficit. Only $10 million, which is nothing. For a city, $10 million is nothing to be in deficit. So what happened? They ignored it. They kept pumping water. General Motors plant decided not to use that water because everything that they build for General Motors, they found out it was rusting faster while it's on the assembly line. They're wondering, why is this metal rusting so fast? They did their personal study and found out high levels of lead, E. coli, in this water. So what did they do? We're sorry. While families are burdened with this new disease based on $10 million deficit. Let me tell you something. $10 million is nothing to our NFL people. Nothing to our come on, people. Trump, nothing. Oh, yeah, nothing to millionaires. Nothing, right? Now, I want you to think about it. Get a hold of this. I got a hold of this. I said, God, I know why you want us. But a believer can buy that water company. $10 million, nothing. I'll buy this water company. We'll buy from Detroit, and we will get clean water for Flint. And the people that are sick, they're going to have to go through something now. $10 million is nothing compared to all those people that get sick. Children are sick. Government's out there passing bottled water. You can't boil this water because it will now kill the lead. They showed a woman turning on the water in the bathtub and all was just look rusty water coming out. And notice this. The governor was told about it. Governor was a little careful in bringing it out because there was money involved in this problem. $10 million is nothing. I'm telling you, church, that's nothing. That's nothing to a person that has millions. What's the highest lottery ticket that was bought? The guy from Chino, California. I know a pastor in Chino, California, and I asked him when I first saw him at the church. I said, hey, brother, was one of your members the one that bought that lottery? He said, brother, it wasn't. If it was, man. Well, the store that sold that little lottery ticket in Chino, What did it make? Made $1 million just for selling that ticket? What am I saying? See, what I'm saying, I'm not saying go out there and get ladles. No, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about now's the time to start believing God. Let me see. If God has prospered you, then start believing God for prosperity and increasing you. If you know who you are in God. Am I sitting here with $1 million status, people? Yes. So do you know who you are in God? You have to start believing. You know, when I read that, the first thing I thought about is, you know, Father, the body can buy that water district. Connect that pipe back to Detroit. Get that Flint, Michigan back and drinking good water. And let's take care. Let's find out what we need to do for these babies. Let's start doing it. What's going to happen? The body of Christ needs to rise up in this hour. And notice this. Now that I say with me, no fear here. God's in control of the righteous. And let me tell you something. What if other things happen like that in Oklahoma City? You may say, well, I drink bottled water anyway. Well, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about what can we do? Think about it. Now, you're probably thinking, Pastor, you're so far out. We'll never bound to that. I think our mentality is so narrow when it comes to the purpose God has for us. Come on, church, the purpose God has for us. What if, Sinji, you're the person God's going to use in a certain situation? What if you, Brother Keith? Jenna, what if you? I mean, retirement's coming for you. But what if God has a plan which you've earned and use it for the kingdom of God? What if you have a plan you don't even know yet, but God knows. Well, I want you to hear this. I know one thing, that I'm standing for people that are great. Come on, church, you ought to say amen. Don't take me to buy dinner. Don't buy me dinner. Just say amen. Say amen, amen, pastor. Come on. I'm among the great. I'm among the greats. Come on, church. Say with me, amen. Receive it. I'm among the million-dollar status people that are headed to billionaire. I'm among them. Why? Because, see, this is what we are. Come on, church. Can you say amen? Now, notice this. This in the Word of God. Just like you believe John 3:16. Say with me, I believe John 3:16. Now, do you believe God's purpose in you to be people of wealth for purpose? Come on, church. Can you say amen? Look at Proverbs. I want you to see. Go with me to Proverbs, the 12th chapter. Come on, church. You ought to be shouting. Come on, church. I'm helping someone here. I'm helping someone here. Hallelujah. Amen. Come on, church. Hallelujah. Do not be mocked. Whatsoever man soweth shall he receive. Pastor, I'm right in there, Father, Pastor, and I'm going to do all that God's called me to do. You're going to receive. Notice what it says in Proverbs, the 13th chapter. Come on, church. The 13th chapter, verse 22. Come on, church. Now, notice this. Oh, let's read first, all right? Are you okay, guys? Are you okay? Verse 22 says, a good man leaveth an inheritance to his children's children, and the wealth of the sinner is laid up for the just. Do you believe that's in the scripture? Am I reading it right? Notice what it says here. Wealthy, wickedly used. Now notice what it says. Good people will have wealth to leave to their grandchildren. But the wealth of sinners will go to the righteous. Come on, church, can you say amen? Let me read to you from the Amplified. A good man leaves an inheritance of moral stability and goodness to his children's children. Now notice this, and the wealth of the sinner, I love this one, I like this one, find its way eventually into the hands of the righteous of whom it is laid up for. I want you to say with me, eventually has come. Look at your neighbor and say, eventually has come. Come on. Eventually has come. Has anybody ever talked to, well, eventually we'll have it one day. Eventually we'll get it one day. I'm believing God for this. Eventually it'll happen eventually. That's faith. For the present or the future, but I want you to have faith for the present. I want you to have faith for the present, now. I'm good before the Lord. I'm righteous before God. Righteous means right standing, having righteousness on you, right living to please God, honoring the Lord. He said, if you will do that for me, then I'll cause the travail of the world to come into your lap. Come on, church. I'll cause that to happen. Amen? A friend of ours, him and his dad were driving. They're powerful men of God in Latin America. They were driving. Now, you got to understand something. When I talk about people of faith, I don't say you quit your job to live by God, trusting God. No, I'm saying what you do at your job, you live by faith. While you counsel people, you're in faith. Or you're learning computers, you're counseling, you're in faith. You're using faith wherever you are. How many people use faith at work? You got to use faith at work. The just shall live by faith. Come on, church, faith, faith, faith. Now notice this. When God has you working, you're living by faith. But now, on the other hand, there's people that live by faith 100%. This father and son were driving, and before I go there, let me just say something. God always would do a miraculous thing when people are in faith. I remember that time I told you I was going to Baytown, Bay City, and God called me from Houston to Bay City to go preach, and we had E on the gas tank, but God told me to go preach. And we didn't have a dollar to put into our gas tank to go, but yet we believed God. He said for me to go. That gas tank, that needle was on E, made it all the way to Bay City, and then it was after we preached that the pastor filled up my tank. That was a miracle. I'll tell you that happened. But anyway, these two men are going, and they're preaching. They're in a Volkswagen. The Lord told the driver, in his not audibly but in his heart, and he told his dad, "Dad, the Lord told me that when we cross over this mountain, there's going to be a bag in the middle of the road, and the Lord wants me to pick it up. I see the bag. I need to go pick it up." And the father said, "Well, if the Lord told you to do it." And guess what? Goes down the hill, there's a bag. And notice this. He pulls over, and then he has fear because he says, anybody can put anything in that bag. You know what I'm talking about? It could be a rattlesnake in that bag, whatever. So he had to overcome fear. So, because first of all, he heard the Lord, but then at the same time, the enemy speaking, saying, you know, there's going to be a snake in that bag. Well, he gets down, gets to that bag, gets that bag, brings it to his Volkswagen, gives it to his father. His father probably is in faith too. So, you know, they open it up. Now listen to this. Bag had a lot of money in this bag. Right? So they make it to the village. He has his bag. He preaches. And he's wanting to know on the newspaper about this bag. Wants to know, has anybody lost money? Of course, that money in this part of the country, you don't have that kind of money in that kind of country. Turn out to be that morning they had a chase with some drug lords. Are you with me, church? And the drug lords were throwing things out of their vehicle. And one of the things they threw out with drugs and everything, I'm sure there was drugs all over the freeway, but just so happened this bag landed. And they realized this scripture. They told me, Pastor Robert, this scripture is so powerful. The Lord will hand over to you the righteous that are doing God's business the wealth of the sinner. You know what he said? He said, I prayed for every person that had bought drugs, that had given this money. I prayed. I said, Lord, I pray for every person they be set free, and I thank you. And he went about preaching the gospel with thousands of dollars in that bag. No. Notice this. How can that be? Did God know? Did God know those drug dealers were being chased? Yeah, he did. Did God know that what they were going to do? Yes, he did. He purposed and planned the right time for these brothers to go down that highway. You see, we can't, if we try to look at it through the natural sense and say, well, it was just luck. No, luck. There's no such thing as luck according to the household of faith. The household of faith don't speak that way. Get rid of lucky talk. Well, it was just luck. It was my horoscope or whatever. Well, I can't pronounce it. It was just coincidence. No, it was, if we're people of faith, we believe the Spirit of God moves us in these areas. Can you say amen, church? See, so this scripture came alive. Now, notice as it says here, and let's look at something. Are you with me, church? Hallelujah, amen. Look what it says. Look at Proverbs, the 13th. Well, we were there, right? Look at it again, Proverbs 13, 22. I want you to see this. Proverbs 13, 22. I want you to look at it again. A good man leaveth an inheritance to his children's children, and the wealth of the sinner is laid up for the just. I just park right there and say, Father, I thank you that you eventually cause the wealth of the world to come into my hands. Church, it'll happen, church, every time. You don't even have to go look for it. God does things in his plan for you. Come on, church. Let's believe God for this wealth to come into your hands so that we can do things that we need to do. Come on, church. See, $10 million is nothing to fix that water problem in Flint. You may say, well, Pastor, we don't even have $1 million. I'm not talking about your limited thought. I'm talking about God's unlimited resources. Amen, church. Come on. See, we can believe God for debt freedom. Start speaking to your house. Every time you pay your note on your house, lay your hands and say, Father, I thank you. This house is being paid off in Jesus' name. Paid off. Free. In Jesus' name. Thank you. Money comes to me now. Go ahead. Let's stand up, church. Thank you, Father, that my notes are being canceled. Money is being returned to me. Money that was lost is being found. Money that was taken from me is being returned. Come on, church. I know people that have been in lawsuits, and this one particular person, their husband died, and they don't have children together, but now his children are coming out of the woodwork, are suing her for wanting the property or the whatever the money or property that she owns. And she says, you know what, I can believe God that he can cancel. I said, yeah, let's cancel that. It can be canceled. Things can be canceled. Amen. I remember always praying, Father, I thank you that winter's coming, we're not going to use much energy. How many people have ever heard me say that? We're not using much energy right now. In the summertime, everybody's talking about their electricity, pulling a lot of electricity. You know, we pray that. Father, we don't have that. Not our house. And it's amazing. We check our energy and we find out we're way below the efficient, way below our neighbors, way below. And people are saying, what? It's the Word of God. Come on, church. We pray refunds of insurance. You know, a couple years ago after the tornadoes, all the house insurances went up because of the tornadoes. We said, not us, in Jesus' name, we believe not. I'm telling you, it's amazing. Companies are looking for you to insure you. Amen. Come on, church, I'm speaking some things that we're living, and it's happening. But now, this is what's taking place according to the Word of God. Its purpose, its design. God intended for the end time church now to rise up, not only in glory, but also in finances, to finance the kingdom. Listen, I want you to get a picture of this. Before Jesus Christ comes, don't you know there's going to be millions coming to Jesus Christ? Muslims are praying, they're seeing Jesus as they kneel down. They're seeing miracles. Remember, we've been praying that. Been praying. Many other churches have been praying. Father, we pray for Muslims that they'll see Jesus in their prayers. This Muslim mosque over here, I want them to see Jesus when they bow down to the wrong God. I want them to see Jesus, and many are starting to do that. It's happening, hallelujah, amen. Family members are coming in that were once hard, that did not know Jesus, are coming into Jesus now. It's happening, hallelujah. Why? Because it's purpose for God to do this, including wealth to the righteous. Wealth to the righteous. I'm telling you, church, you ought to be bold in your confession. Say, Father, this is for me. This is for me. Come on, church. This is for me. Come on, church. This is for me. I'm telling you, church, it's amazing what God does. Going back to business, when we had business, there was an elderly lady that came to our shop, and she came with a sound in her engine, and she said that everybody told her it was an engine, wanted to charge her $2,000. I told her mechanic to look at it. All it was a nickel, 10 cents bolt. And I said, ma'am, all it was a loose bolt. We're putting it back on. You time. So how much are you? I said, oh, no, go. This woman went back to where she lived. She lived in this, come on, church, help me out. Somebody help me out here. A retirement center, but it's a beautiful place. Beautiful place. It's assisted living, whatever. I don't know what it's called, but it's beautiful housing. She told everybody there that there is a mechanic down the road that will fix you. Phones started ringing off the shelves. I told Christine, Christine was my secretary back then, she would see all these cars of people, elderly, coming in. These elderly just loved our work. Oh, we got into the paint and body business because elderly were needing their cars painted. We started doing it. Oh, what was happening? God bringing in the wealth. Come on, church. They didn't know Jesus, but they sure knew where to get a good dollar and trust a person. Amen. Or get a good price for their price. Amen. See, God started doing that. God can do that for you right now. Do you believe the church? Do you believe it? If you have a problem right now in the financial realm right now, I want you to look at that financial problem and let it stand next to the Almighty God. Which one is bigger? Which one is taller? Which one is mighty? You figure it out right now. You choose right now. Which one is greater, this problem or God? Now give it to God right now.